Praise the Lord. The good place to get out of the rain is just jump in your car and don't even bother about the rain. It's outside, right?
As we go on to chapter 8 in John.
Now, chapter 8 is all about the woman that's caught in adultery in the very act. Now, it's interesting that the second statement is made. Caught in adultery in the very act. Now, I think I could be wrong on this. You know, you guys, you know, you can do some research yourself, you know. So, but it was said in the ancient times, way, way back, if it come back in time here to Leviticus, that if a man caught his wife, that is one thing, but if he suspected his wife, even if he suspected his wife without any hard evidence, it was said that he could make his wife eat water, eat dirt mixed with water, or drink dirt, or drink water mixed with dirt. And if she lived, then that she was not guilty. But if she passed on and died or got sick, I guess she was guilty. Kind of like an ordeal, it's called. You've heard of the medieval ordeal of water, where they threw the witch into the pool of water, and if she sank, then she was innocent. But if she rose to the surface, that means the devil rejected her, and that she was okay, and she was not guilty. So I think, you know, the judicial system might have come just a little bit further along, you know. But in Jesus' time, and that's what we're going to read about here in John chapter 8, is a bunch of guys, probably buddies, saying, you know, we caught this guy's wife. We caught her in the very act. So, Jesus, what should you do? Did not. It's kind of like, you know, do you pay taxes to Caesar or not? So, the idea or the intent behind it, of course, was that they wanted to trap Jesus. But here's the most interesting part that I found. And that is that he stooped down and wrote in the dirt. Now, what's the dirt significant of? It's the fact that the law said, back in Leviticus 22, said that she had to drink water mixed with dirt. So if she survived, you know, everything was okay. If she died, then there was a penalty there. So... So what we understand is God is giving Jesus some insight that perhaps people didn't realize, you know, he had
ordeal,
because the ordeal in water was similar to what John experienced, but what he experienced, the tradition of the church says that he experienced a boiling in oil, but the oil or the heat had no power over his body. So the Apostle John was dipped in oil that was supposedly burning, and yet he survived. And so I think the Roman authorities thought that perhaps we should just exile him, get him out of here. And that's what they did. They exiled John to the Isle of Patmos, where he wrote the book of Revelation. And he was exiled there in pretty much isolation. But also, we should note that John was also, at one time, he was the bishop or the overseer of the Church of Ephesus. And in that capacity, really, he had an opportunity to encourage all the seven churches of that Asia Minor area. Of Ephesus, northern Ephesus, if you go through, there's all of these seven churches, like I mentioned in another video. But it's interesting that Paul, in chapter 11 of 2 Corinthians, he talks about himself going through an ordeal, in that at Lystra, if you remember in Acts, he was stoned and was pretty much thought to be dead, but then he was taken up alive. But he says in this that he was caught up to the third heaven, where he heard things that was unlawful for a man to utter.
We know that God has a preservation for the Christian. We can meet out under the trees at where we go. We can meet out in open fields, just like the first century and just like the Chinese people do today, because they're under severe persecution. If you thought to worship the Lord, then you might be an enemy of the state. So in the persecution today, you don't really have to be caught in adultery. You don't have to be caught doing something like that. But just being caught worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. So we're near and dear to our Chinese brothers and sisters, and we always need to pray. Not only for our own society and our own government, but also for the government of the world, for the people in the world that are suffering for Jesus. Sometimes when we read in the Bible of different events, it doesn't seem like it affects us too much. You know, it's a different time, it's a different place, under different rulers and circumstances. And the early Christians were under the authority of tyrannical rulers. And that's how people can get, and that's how rulers can get. Because, as we know, this absolute power corrupts people. It's just natural. It's just how the world descends into chaos. It descends into a mindless status. So we're reminded every time we get together that only Jesus has the order that we need to live in. The order that Christ has in our life gives us strength and health. I gotta say that, because he takes away a lot of the anxiety that exists in as being the byproduct or the after effect or the side effects of a status of sin, being in a state of sin or being in a toxic path, you know, that where you're going in life is a toxic place, and God wants us to be walking in a healthy place. He wants us to be healthy because he inhabits the praises of our people. He inhabits our hearts and minds. Actually, this goes back to us being the temple of the Holy Spirit. Paul talks about it. All the apostles talk about it in their letters, that our body is to be preserved, is to be helped. And we're not to use things, you know, that are detrimental to our health. So I think it's good if we teach the Bible, we also teach all of the ramifications and all of the side effects and all of the things, you know, that make up a holistic view of the Christian life. And that's found in the Bible, but it's also found in our own common sense and how the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, directs our paths and gives us an increased discernment between good and evil. And Paul even says to exercise our faith, to exercise our discernment, really, between good and evil. And we get this from our teaching, from being reminded. I know I need to be reminded. It's so easily, you know, we so easily forget these things. But then when we come back to study, what does it do? It just refreshes us. You know, we're drawing from the deep, deep well of Scripture, bringing insight up into a refreshing drink so that we're refreshed and renewed, and so that we can go through the path that God has chosen to us. A lot of these paths, I know I listen to people, a lot of the paths that the Lord's put us on are probably not as easy, you know, or as enjoyable as you'd like, but yet God shows a deep conviction and a deep meaning for our life. Whatever ministry you're in, God has put you there. So we're praise the Lord. God bless you guys this week. You know, this next Wednesday we're going to finish chapter 8, but we're also going to go at the B part, what I call the B or the C part, because I don't take the whole chapter, it is too much. But the B part is about Jesus being the light of the world. Now remember, all the things that Jesus said, we go back and we see, well, he's the bread of life and no man will hunger or thirst if we have Jesus. But he's also going to say that no man's going to walk in darkness because he is the light of the world. And that's what we're going to begin next time as we finish chapter 8 about the woman caught in adultery and go on to verse 12 where Jesus proclaims himself as being the light of the world. And that's interesting. I can't really wait to get into it. But God bless you this week. Continue on. And Jesus' name, amen.